700 anti-Wall Street protesters are arrested on the Brooklyn Bridge. 21,000 Detroiters lose welfare benefits. Should we drug test welfare recipients? And Facebook gets caught peeping through your window, figuratively.
Oh, yeah.
Hey guys, it's October 2nd, 2011. My name is Reginald, and I'm also known as DEMCAD. First, Wall Street. Well, over 700 anti-Wall Street protesters were arrested on the Brooklyn Bridge after they attempted to stop traffic. Police responded pretty quickly. This is a part of the Occupy Wall Street movement. It seems to be getting a lot bigger now. A lot more people involved, and they're starting to disrupt bigger and different parts of the actual city. And I think it's a better move for them. But ultimately, when it comes to banks, if you don't hit them in the pocketbook, it really doesn't matter, because that's what matters the most. Speaking of banks, Bank of America is going to start to charge their customers a $5 monthly fee for using their debit cards. And other big banks are expected to follow suit. What do you think about that? You think that's fair? I guess you can always go to a different bank or a credit union. 21,000 Detroiters are going to lose benefits, okay? And Rick Snyder, governor of Michigan, signed in some welfare reform that limited cash benefits to 48 months. Okay, that's your lifetime limit. Once you hit that, you're pretty much cut off for the cash benefits. And a lot of people have been living off this for a long period of time. And it looks like there's going to be 41,000 people statewide who's going to lose their benefits, averaging $515 a month. But most of this is going to be impacted in urban areas, specifically 21,000 Detroiters. Okay, in one zip code, 48205, is a 5-square-mile area. It's in the northeastern part of Detroit. 2,000 adults and 1,500 kids are going to be cut off. That's tremendous. 21,000 people in one city, roughly 1 in 10 children in Detroit and Flint, will lose welfare benefits starting Saturday. Holy smokes. I understand the need to limit this because you can't have people living off this forever. However, when you have an economic situation where there's not a lot of jobs, what do you think the impact of this is going to be? In Michigan, we have an unemployment rate that recently rose to 11.2%. However, it's not as high as the 14.1% we reached in mid-2009. However, I'm not convinced that the manufacturing jobs came back so much that it caused a significant drop in unemployment. I'm not convinced that unemployment dropped that much, but anyway, it did rise to 11.2%. In California, it inched up from 12% to 12.1% as employers continued to cut jobs and reducing payrolls. Well, pretty much the same thing. In Florida, they still have a stubbornly high jobless rate of 10.7%, but it's not nearly as high as their 12% unemployment rate in December. Tell me, if you're in Florida, did you really notice the unemployment actually going down? Was there actually an influx of jobs that I didn't really catch or anything? Because I'm living in Michigan right now, and I don't think the situation is much better than it was in 2009. Speaking of which, and speaking of Florida, should we drug test welfare recipients? I always thought that was sort of a bad idea because it costs money to drug test people. I mean, how often are you going to actually do it? Once? Or what? You have to drug test them more than once to make it even somewhat effective, because you know, a lot of drugs are out of your system in like 24 hours. And of course, American Civil Liberties Union is challenging this law, but according to the Justice Department, only 6% of Americans over the age of 12 are actually using illegal drugs. Now, when you look at the Associated Press's report on these 2,000 people who have been tested since July, only 2.5% of them actually tested positive. So obviously it wasn't really a lot of people using illegal drugs and on welfare to begin with. Or maybe they weren't tested enough. Either way, I don't think this is going to be very cost effective. Anyway, personal income in the U.S. dropped 0.1%. In Canada, their GDP grew 0.3% in July, 0.2% in June. Pending home sales for the U.S. dipped 1.2%. but they actually had a index increase of 7.7% when you compare it to August 2010. Facebook. This is really creepy. On a scale of 1 to 10 on a creepometer, this is somewhere between a 9 and a 10. They have over 750 million users, and Facebook was busted spying on their their users. Well, essentially, they had a setup so that they were able to not only track people online as they were using Facebook, but they were even able to track people even when they went off of Facebook. Even when you logged out of Facebook, people's computers were inadvertently sending information to the company, whether they were logged in or not, which is tantamount to peeping through somebody's window. but now they say that, oh, well, we fixed a problem, which is sort of like peeping through somebody's window and then saying, oh, I'm not going to do it again. I thought about actually shutting down my account, but I thought, you know, this is a good tool for me to actually spread information, particularly by video, but at the same time, how can I really trust these guys? They say that, oh, we fixed a problem, but really? All right, guys, thanks for watching. Tell me what you think, and don't forget to feature vlogs of those who prepare for it today. Bye.